lecture about microbiomes and microbiota. And now it's a pleasure of mine to introduce one of my friends. I consider him a friend because we have met more than one time in Alexandria, Professore Fabio Medulla. Buongiorno, signore. Come stai? Now, I go back to the English language because I'm not so fit in Italiano. Professore Fabio Medulla will talk about protracted bacterial bronchitis.
Good morning. I'm really very happy to stay with you also this morning. And I would like to thank very much my friends, Professor Deraz and Professor Fuda, for the invitation, and also Professor Kairi and Professor Nassar. So today I will speak about protracted bacterial bronchitis, and I'm starting from cough. I think that you all know that cough is the single most common reason for primary care physician visit, and when it is chronic, is a frequent indication to refer to a specialist visit. Cough without cold has a prevalence of almost 30% in boys and 30% in girls. And when you have a child with cough, the etiology of coughing covers a wide spectrum of respiratory disorders. And when you have a child with chronic cough, you know that is often associated with significant morbidity and a reduced quality of life. There are several guidelines on the definition of cough and on the etiology of cough in children. I'm reporting here the results of the guideline that was published in Thorax 2008. And when you have a child with cough, you can define cough on the duration, on the etiology, and the quality. Duration, you may have a child with acute cough that lasts less than 3 weeks. Chronic cough, depending of the UK guidelines or the Australian guidelines, is a cough that lasts more than 4 or 8 weeks. You may have a child prolonged acute cough, usually that is resolving over 3-8 weeks, and is usually secondary to a viral infection, or a child with a recurrent cough. About the etiology, you can have post-viral cough, a specific cough with a clear identifiable cause, and you may have a child with no specific isolated cough that is a persistent dry cough and no other respiratory symptoms. And on the quality, you may have a child with dry, brassy, barking, moist, productive, and wet cough. And I would like to offer my presentation on wet cough. What does it mean, wet cough? When a child has a wet cough, that means that there is a presence of excessive airway mucus. And we don't know how much mucus is required and where it should be located for the human to hear to detect the presence of a wet cough. Children with persistent wet cough should be investigated to rule out the presence of bronchiectasis or any other specific suppurative lung condition that can lead to bronchiectasis. And a cough that sounds wet implies either increase in airway secretion or abnormalities in its clearance mechanism. So wet cough means mucus hypersecretory that can occur from a variety of mechanisms that is reported in the slides, or situation where hypersecretory state occurs chronically, and these are relatively limited in children. And you should think about aspiration lung disease, bronchiectasis, lung abscess, or atypical pulmonary infection, so tuberculosis. This is a study of many years ago. It was published in 2005 on cough quality in children, and it was a comparison of subject versus bronchoscopy findings. The aims of the study, it was to compare cough quality, wet and dry, to bronchoscopy finding of secretion, and compare parents and clinician evaluation of the cough quality. They studied 106 children. It was a prospective study, and cough quality was independently evaluated by clinician and parents, and the blinded clinician scored the secretion seen at bronchoscopy. And the results show that there was a good agreement between a parent assessment of cough and clinician assessment of cough, but when the results were compared to bronchoscopy finding of secretion, clinician cough assessment has the highest sensitivity and specificity comparing to parents and were marginally better than parents. You all know that when you have a child with chronic wet cough, you should think about the clinical conditions that are reported in these slides, such as cystic fibrosis, and you know very well which are the investigations to perform, immunodeficiency, planar ciliary dyskinesia, recurrent palmar aspiration that could be consequence of pharyngeal cleft or H-type tracheoesophageal fistula, or post-tracheoesophageal fistula repair with swelling in coordination, or a child with neuromuscular neurodevelopmental disorder, gastroesophageal reflux, and hiatal hernia, or a child with a taint in a foreign body, or a child with tuberculosis, or with anatomic disorders such as bronchomalacia, or lung malformations such as cystic congenital thoracic malformation, and children with interstitial lung disease. We also know that when you have a child with chronic wet cough, you should look for specific pointers that can be systemic pointers or pulmonary pointers. And according to these clinical findings, you can direct your diagnosis. But when you have a child with chronic wet cough without specific pointers, what clinical entity is this one? So this is the question. I would like to go back to a very old paper that was published in 1981, so almost 40 years ago, but in my opinion, it's very actually. This paper was published by Lynn Tausing, that at that time was a young pediatric pulmonologist in Tucson, Arizona. The rationale of the study is that considering the high rate for chronic bronchitis in children, it's astonishing that there are almost no publication on clinical characteristics, etiology factor, treatment or prognosis. In fact, major pediatric textbooks and pediatric pulmonary reference make little or no mention on pediatric chronic bronchitis. The design was they send questionnaires on diagnosis, etiology, and treatment of chronic bronchitis to 103 pediatricians, and the results were recurrent episode of wet cough lasting 2 weeks was the most important criteria for the diagnosis. So these are the results of the questionnaire. Pediatricians think that chronic bronchitis in childhood may have considerable overlap with asthma with respect to etiology, pathophysiology, and treatment. And many pediatricians concluded that there were few ways to distinguish asthma for chronic bronchitis in children. The conclusion of the authors was that chronic bronchitis was not a diagnosis commonly made by pediatrician, and considering the relationship between pediatric respiratory illness and chronic lung disease in adults, it is unlucky that no depth studies exist on the clinical, allergic, immunological, and physiological characteristics of children with chronic bronchitis. And the validity of separating children with asthma or chronic bronchitis, it was at that time an open question, in my opinion, is still an open question also nowadays. And the overlap between these two entities appears to be extensive, and the different prognoses for each need to be carefully compared. Because I think that today, many children with chronic bronchitis are treated as asthma. So from 1981, we moved to 2006 with a paper that was published by the group of Anna Chang from Brisbane, Australia, on the evaluation and outcome of young children with chronic cough. They performed a prospective cohort single center study to evaluate the use of an adult-based algorithm for chronic cough, and they tried to describe the etiology of chronic cough. They studied 108 children with chronic cough that was lasting for more than 4 weeks, who perform a pathway in the investigation that include also Fibrotic bronchoscopy and bronchoalveolar lavage. The diagnostic criteria categories were reached using a standard, were standardized a priori, and for the first time, they were started to speak about protracted bacterial bronchitis that was defined a priori as a presence of chronic wet cough, positive bulk culture, and the response to treatment with amoxicillin and clavulanic acid. And here I report the results of this study. You see that a primary a wet cough, most of the children, so almost 90% of the children had a wet cough, and only 11% have a dry cough, that the primary diagnosis was obtained in 98 patients, so that represent 91% of the children, and protracted bacterial bronchitis was the most frequent diagnosis that was present in almost 40% of the children. Where they compare BAL, differential cell count in children with a protracted bacterial bronchitis and the children with other diagnosis, they show that in these children there was a higher concentration of BL neutrophils, and in this patient they also detect with culture immuninfluenza, Haemophilus influenza in 47% of the children, Mantle catarrhalis and Streptococcus pneumoniae. From this study, it was clear evident that protracted bacterial bronchitis was a ben precise, a good, very well precise clinical entity. From this study, in most of the national guidelines on pediatric chronic cough, in the differential diagnosis was presented also the possibility of to look for a protracted bacterial bronchitis. And these are some of the studies that came out after the 2006 on the percentage of children with a protracted bacterial bronchitis when they study a group, a small a cohort of patients with chronic wet cough. So the prevalence in children with chronic wet cough can range from 6% study that was published in Turkey to 42% in two studies that were published in Australia from by Anna Chang. From 2006, we arrive to 2017 when the European Respiratory Society decide to organize a guidelines on a statement on protracted bacterial bronchitis in children, and I have the honor of to participate in these guidelines. It was performed in 10 specific questions, K question, with a systemic review of the literature, and a consensus was defined a priori as an agreement by more than 80% of the group. In the guidelines, protracted bacterial bronchitis was defined as a presence of chronic wet cough for more than 4 weeks, lower airway infection, so in a BL or sputum with more than 10 out of 4 coliforming units of bacteria, and a child that where the cough resolved following a 2 weeks course of an appropriate oral antibiotics, and the antibiotic of choice is amoxicillin and clavulanic acid given for 2 weeks. Because of the fact that not all children can perform bronchoscopy evaluation, they decide to have a more clinical definition that was a presence of chronic wet cough, absence of symptom or sign of other causes of wet cough, so children without specific systemic of pulmonary pointers, and the cough that resolved following a 2 weeks course of amoxicillin and clavulanic acid. They also define a protracted bacterial bacterial bronchitis extended, so where you need more than 4 weeks of antibiotic treatment to resolve the problem, or a child may have more than 3 episodes per year, so we're speaking about recurrent protracted bacterial bronchitis. This is a study coming always from the Australian studies, Australian group, where they try to define the age of children with a PBB, with protracted bacterial bronchitis. And as you can see, they studied 346 children from 8 hospitals. Again, the criteria, diagnostic criteria were categories was defined a priori. You will see that a PBB was diagnosed in 41% of the children. And as you can see from this slides, most of the children with the protracted bacterial bronchitis have an age less than 6 years. So this clinical entity is more common in children in the first years of life. This is another study from Australia on 104 children, where they try to characterize under the clinical point of view children with PBB, but they've shown that there was no increased prevalence of atopic fissures, lack of systemic symptom and sign, so only chronic wet cough, normal growth and development. Children frequently attend child care. There were no difference on smoke exposure, normal chest X-ray, and normal lung function test. And when they look for BL, the main the main bacteria that were detected were, again, Haemophilus influenzae, Streptococcus pneumoniae, Meloxella catarrhalis, Staphylococcus aureus, and they concluded that it was important to sampling from different lobes when you perform lavage. About virus, this is the same study. The only virus that they detect in the BL was adenovirus, but the real meaning of detecting adenovirus in these children is really very difficult. This is another study from Australia where they look for microbiota profile, and what they demonstrate that the microbiota profile may differentiate children with bronchiectasis from children with PBB, so two different clinical entities. You will see the children with the bronchiectasis are those with the red spots, and children with the PBB are those with the light blue. And you see that clearly are different. They have different microbiota. This was a nasal and oral swab taken from 78 children. And this is another study from Australia where they look for immunity in patients with PBB. And as you can see from these slides, all immunoglobulin, subclass of immunoglobulin, lymphocyte subset analysis, and the response to vaccine were completely normal in children with protected bacterial pneumonia. So no immunological problem. There are some studies always coming from Australia where they have demonstrated that this children may have some defect on the innate immune response, but this result should be confirmed in other studies. And this is finally the first study coming from North America, looking for bronchoscopic finding children with chronic wet cough. It was a retrospective study in 197 children. They found purulent bronchitis in 56 of the children and positive bulk culture in 46% of the children. And they show that purulent bronchitis, so those children with purulent bronchitis, have more often a positive bulk culture and more often ABL neutrophilia. And so they found that children have evidence with the chronic wet cough, have a common evidence of purulent bronchitis on bronchoscopy. This is another study, always from North America, where they found, it's a retrospective study, where they found an association between PBB and bronchomalacia and trachomalacia, but they cannot define if the association was primary, so are Malaysia predisposed to PBB, or it is secondary, so that PBB is associated to Malaysia because that develops because intensive away inflammation. So finally, let's see which is the treatment. This was a randomized controlled trial on amoxicillin clavulanate acid in children with chronic wet cough. And you see that in this study, it was a double-blind RCT study in 50 children. And the primary outcome was cough resolution. And the secondary outcome, the verbal category descriptive score. And as you can see, the treatment group had a significant reduction on cough and VCD. And this, and again, is another study on the outcome of patients with protracted bacterial bronchitis that perform bronchoscopy. Is a retrospective study in 44 children with PBB. They found a bulk culture positive in 48% of the patients, and 77% of the patients resolved with antibiotics. 24 remain cough free, and 9% have three or more recurrent episodes despite antibiotic treatment. So there was a good response of PBB children with amoxicillin and clavulanic acid. And this is the follow-up. It's again an Australian study. So what is happening in a child where you do not make the diagnosis of PVB or who doesn't respond to antibiotic treatment? Is a retrospective study on 144 children with chronic wet cough. They have information on age, sex, ethnicity, response to 4 weeks antibiotic, and TC scan. And among 105 children, persistent cough, despite 4 weeks of antibiotic, 83% had bronchiectasis, and the 24 children whose cough resolved after antibiotic, only 25% of children had a bronchiectasis. So the conclusion of this author was that protracted bacterial bronchitis is the first step of a disease that can progress from protracted bacterial bronchitis to chronic supportive lung disease or to radiological evidence of bronchiectasis that can be reversible or irreversible. So PBB, chronic supportive lung disease, and bronchiectasis represent different ends of the same spectrum. So if you do not make the diagnosis of PBB or those children do not respond to 2 weeks or 4 weeks of medical treatment, there is a high probability that these children may develop chronic supportive lung disease and finally bronchiectasis. So in conclusion, I think that nowadays a chronic bacterial bronchitis may be considered a clinical entity, but this definition is not accepted from all the pediatric population. And probably PBB reflects the old definition of chronic bronchitis or supportive bronchitis. We should recognize that the effort that has been done mainly by the group in Brisbane, Australia, to categorize this entity, because most of the study on the PBB come from Australia or from the group of Anna Chang. And we need prospective longitudinal studies and multicentric randomized clinical trials to better define PBB. And clearly, there is a link between PBB and the development of bronchiectasis in children. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Fabio, for your interesting and practical talk. Thanks a lot, Professor Dr. Sanaa Abdulrahman from Kentucky, for the practical and important talk about microbiome and asthma. And we will open the discussion for any question or comment with Professor Fabio and Professor Sanaa.
Not the
no question? Thank you very much. Dr. Saleh has a question for Dr. Saleh.
My question is for Dr. Fabio. Can we diagnose the protracted bacterial bronchitis by just the unresolved wet cough without doing cultures or doing the BAL and to give the antibiotic for 2 weeks only without cultures?
May I answer? Did you listen to me?
Yes.
Okay, good morning.
Good morning,
Fabio. Yes, from Rome. Yes, according to the US guidelines, there is a clinical definition of PBB. So the diagnosis is according to the presence of a chronic wet cough for 4 weeks. But what is important that you should rule out all the other diagnoses. So in my opinion, it's not too easy to make a diagnosis of PBB. You should think about it, but you should be sure that these kids do not have other clinical situation.
Thank you, Professor Fabio. Thank you, Professor Sanaa. And next Congress, inshallah, we'll hope to join together to be with us to enjoy our Congress and stay in Cairo physically, inshallah.
I hope so, next year.
Thank you, Professor Bashir. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
الشكر موصول للسادة الزملاء الأعزاء الأفاضل الأستاذ دكتور صالح الدراز الأستاذ دكتور إيهاب خيري الأستاذ دكتور أيمن فودة، الأستاذ الأستاذ دكتور مي نصر على الدعوة الكريمة، مؤتمرنا الجميل اللي احنا بنبقى حريصين ان احنا جزء نبقى جزء منه. الجلسة الجاية اللي هتقولها البروفيسور سامية نصر اللي هي يعني دايركتور اوف سيستيك فايبروزيس ريسيرش سنتر في ميتشيغان يونيفرسيتي، التايتل سيستيك فايبروزيس كومبليكيشنز اند كوموربيديتيز.